and the church is a home. I'm sure all of you know that there's a difference between a home and a house, right? Okay, so what makes a home? Different. Love. Very good. Okay, without love in a family, alright, it becomes just a house. Nice house, big house, with everything very comfortable, aircon, a big space, you know, but it's a house. Just like in a church. It doesn't mean that brilliant church, good church, must not have nice aircon and nice buildings, chairs and all that. Brilliant church can have all these, but without love, a church cannot be brilliant. Okay? So it tells us that church is a home. It defines how we then relate to one another in our church. As we say that it is love that builds our home. It is love that builds our church. LHMC is going to be a brilliant church. It has to be a church that's characterized by genuine love. And our relationship with one another, when we enter into this home, we are no longer segregated by our demographics. Right? This one, this cartoon says, welcome to our church, though you are sitting on our family pew. We are not segregated by, you know, your family or your social group. The rich people sit in front, the poor people sit in the back, or those who are influential gets to serve in front, those who are not influential sit in front. You know, it's not all that. The church is a family, and we enter into the home of God. We are defined by our relationship with one another as the children of God, as brothers and sisters. It is very important how we look at the church. The church is not an entertainment place. It is not an institution or organization. The church is a family. And how we relate with one another is a family, as a family. And what characterizes our relationship with another is love. It's genuine love for one another. They say that you won't know what is real love if you only learn to laugh with a person. You know what it means to really love a person when you cry with a person. So what does it mean? It means that in our relationship with one another and church members, there is a need for us to truly care, to truly be there for one person when they are happy, when they are strong, when their things are good, but also be there when one is struggling, when one is having difficulties. Right? And people can't let you into their life unless they sense you're genuine, correct? And you can only be genuine if you love God. You love God, you automatically have a love for others. You don't love God, you don't love others. Why I say this is because many times in church we are very cautious because we know there are some people who are not genuine. They claim to be Christian, but they are not really Christian. Okay? Now these people who pretend to be Christian because they want perhaps to have some advantage. You know, maybe they think church is a good place to sell insurance, for example. Come to the church, you know, the only intention is to sell insurance. But there's no genuine conversion in the person, or the person has a genuine love for God. For such person, I think it's quite clear cut. We don't think that this person is a family member of God. But for the rest of us who love God, who has a belief in Jesus Christ, how we relate to one another is as family members. This is our hope. Alright? And I hope that this will characterize LHMC. Sometimes we tend to feel that church must be characterized by the exteriors. But no, you can only be brilliant if you have the genuine love for God and for others. Teoh once says this, he's a great evangelist. He says this, show me a church where there is love and I will show you a church that is a power in the community. He gave this illustration. He says there was once a boy, okay, who attends this Sunday school. One day the family moved to another side of the town, which is really far. But he still continues to go back to this Sunday school. He has to walk a great distance just to get back to that church Sunday school. And his friends ask him, hey, you crazy, why every Sunday, you know, walk so far? There's so many other churches around you. There's so many other Sunday schools that are good you can attend. And he said this, I go back every week because they love a fellow there. They love a fellow there. That means when he goes back to Sunday school, he feels that they love him as a person. he experienced that love. And this is the what that characterized our relationship with one another. That we, this week onwards, we will learn to love a fellow, love a person. And it's more than just, you know, for us to just hi-bye and just have some refreshment. Perhaps it requires us to do more than this. Right? Maybe to spend some time over meals together, to visit one another, to drop a call one another, whatever love that you, the way you can, you think you can express your concern to another. And the second thing that ties us together as a family, the common ground that we always have is the gospel of Jesus Christ. When we, the church is a mixed group of people. You have people who want, some people like to worship loud, some people like to worship quietly. Some people like to, they have different ways of how they want to go about. But one thing that ties us together is that our aim is always the gospel of Jesus Christ. Okay? We help others to understand more of Christ and also bring others to know Christ. And this is what will unite our family, our church family together. In the second part of this story, we talk about another group. And this group are the religious teachers, the teachers of the law from Jerusalem. Okay? They also have greatly misunderstood Jesus. And now we are told they think that Jesus is possessed by Satan. Okay? You can see this in verse 22. And the teachers of the law came down from Jerusalem and said, he is possessed by Jezebel, by a prince of demons, he is driving out demons. Jesus counter and rebuttals this by giving a parable. Alright? The parable, he said this. How can Satan drive out Satan? Verse 23 and verse 24. If a kingdom is divided against itself, the kingdom cannot stand. If a house is divided against itself, the house cannot stand. And if Satan opposes himself and is divided, he cannot stand. His end has come. Jesus is explaining this. He's saying that logically there is no way that I am actually acting as an ally of Satan. Because if I am, Satan is bringing doom to himself. How can you fight within yourself? It's like a country that is in civil war. Every day, in the same country, Party A bombs Party B, Party B bombs Party A. There is chaos, everybody is running around. How can such a country grow? The country will be self-destructive, right? It will destruct. So, in other words, Jesus is saying, it's not that I am, I think that I'm able to cast out demons because I have the power that comes from Satan or I'm possessed. Right? Because it makes no sense. If I'm doing that, then kingdom, the Satan's kingdom will be destroyed. It's self-destructive. And then he offers the explanation. You know how and why I can actually cast out the demons? It's because there is another way that one kingdom can be brought down. And that is if somebody from outside attacks that kingdom. And Jesus is saying that he's the one. He is the one that has come to destroy and to attack the kingdom of Satan. He is the person that has bound the strong man. Now, this, imagine this. This is a stronghold of Satan, alright? And he captures within him people who are in bondage. And he keeps them. The only way you can rescue the people out is if you enter, you are actually able to enter inside the tight security governed by all his little demons, right? And then tie him up. And only then you can unlock and open all the cells and set the captives whoever has been captured inside. And that's what Jesus said he did. The only reason why he can have, they get cast off is because now he's the one who has come and attacked the kingdom of Satan, and he's the one that has tied Satan up. Now what does this tell us? That Jesus reveals and defines what is the ministry of God, what is the work of God. The work of God is to actually bind the work of Satan and to set the captives free. It is actually breaking bondages. As a family of God, one of the things that we do as a family of God is to help people to break the bondages in their life. It can be physical bondages, it can also be spiritual bondages. The church is not in just running programs and all that. The church has a great mission. The church has a great work that God has placed to do. You are part of a very important as well as a very very serious work. It's the breaking the bondages, right, of lives. And there are many bondages in life. Some bondages are physical bondages, poverty. When somebody's poor, they get into a cycle. They are not able to provide enough for the family, they get depressed, they get into certain kind of malaise, and then the family is broken, the children is broken, and then the cycle repeats. Breaking the bondages of sin, the church has begun to do that. That's why in the missionary work, when it first came to Malaysia, we set up schools. Because it's one way to help people to come out of poverty, providing education. Right. There are also the bondages of spiritual bondages, addictions. The most subtle ones are materialism, idolatry. The church is in the business of breaking bondages. And this is what we are called to do as part of God's people. And Jesus says this in the last part. To those people who, to these teachers of the law, who think that Jesus is acting by the power, with the power of Satan, he gives them this very strong warning. Okay? This is a very scary verse. I don't know how many of you read this verse and got a bit scared. Let me read to you in verse 28 to 29. Truly I tell you, people can be forgiven all their sins and every slander they utter. But whoever blasphemes against the Holy Spirit will never be forgiven. They are guilty of eternal sin. It's very scary, right? Some people will think that it's a very scary verse. But if you are very scared of this verse, and you are very scared that you may have done something against the Holy Spirit, and you are really thinking and hoping that you didn't, and if you did, you're so sorry if you've ever done anything like that, let me assure you, you are not condemned. That you are not, you didn't do anything that is unforgivable. Okay. So what does it mean then that to blaspheme against the Holy Spirit? First of all, let's look at verse 28. It says, all sin and all blasphemy can be forgiven. Okay? It means that as long as a person repents, doesn't matter how deep the sin is, how terrible the sin is, how great the blessing is. The person repent, God will forgive. Right? But why he says that blaspheme against the Holy Spirit is not forgivable is actually a warning. It's in the context of a warning that if you continually reject what God is doing in your life and you are not repentant, then at the end, you will never be forgiven. Right? Let me use the words of William Barclay to explain this. Is the Holy Spirit enables man to recognize God's truth when he enters their life. But if man refuses to exercise any God-given faculty, he will in the end lose it. If a man lives in the dark long enough, he will lose the power to see. If a man stays in the bed long enough, he will lose the power to walk. If a man refuses to do any serious study, he loses the power to study. If a man refuses the guidance of God's Spirit often enough, he becomes incapable of recognizing the truth when he sees it. Evil to him becomes good, and good becomes evil. He can look on the goodness of God and call it the evil of Satan. This is what the teachers of God did. The work of God setting the captives free. The demonic possessed person, they claim it is the work of Satan. Such persons have lost the faculty of able to understand the truth of God because they have continually rejected God's working for them. The warning that Jesus actually is telling them. If you really continue like this, continue to reject the truth that God's Spirit is giving you, you will end up unforgiven and end up in eternal condemnation.
For those who come very close,
someone said this, he said, I really believe that they are the damn I really believe that the damn are, in one sense, successfully rebels to the end. The doors of hell are locked on the audio system so that they can hear some nice means that for those who have refused God, refused the truth of God, refused the little thing enough, except that the Holy Spirit is trying to bring things to their minds and their hearts. They reject it continually. They actually end up rocking.
Vending machines,
itself,
coffee makers, you know, feel free, you know, to roam around. And
the doors of hell are locked from the inside. It's not that hell is a small and not that hell is right in itself inside.
It's not the common spirit.
This is the warning, the warning that Jesus gives to those within the teachers of the law and to us behind that we should always be happy to place what harden ourselves with into God. If not, then we end up using our ability to listen,
to make you feel comfortable.
We end up being outsiders, designing or insiders. And then, let me close today's sharing this words with God, with this word says about that, the church. What it means to be an insider of God, who come to the family of God, is characterized by our love for one another. And that love comes from our family love for God. The church is, and it is what characterizes the work of those who are inside families to do God's will, be part of God's will, to bring bondages and most importantly, to recognize that we are people who are broken by each other and we will continue to be sensitive to God's working. And if there any way that we have not done right, there is always a sense of repentance and we heed the warning to not be a stumbling block to God's work. So let us spend this time in prayer. Let's just close this time in prayer. That's what happens. Lord, I want to thank you for your word that you have taught us, Lord, that the church is your family. It's where the true home is. We pray, O God, that our church, LHMC, will indeed be a brilliant church characterized by our love for you and our love for one another. It always doesn't seem to be very impressive when the church is based on love that working, because it's not something that flaunts itself. It's not something that will seek others to be impressed. But Lord, this is what it means to do your will. So Lord, help us, O God, when we look at one another, that we will look at one another as fellow members of your family. Lord, help us, O God, to have a deeper love for one another, to learn to not only enjoy good times together, but to learn to be there for one another. Difficult times. We pray, O God, that Lord, you will help us with our own insecurities. Sometimes we are afraid to open up to others because we are afraid that we will be hurt. But Lord, we pray that you will strengthen our love for one another, that trust can be developed, that people, O God, can genuinely open up and be themselves to one another. We also can be people who will learn to build up one another, to learn to speak truth, O God, even when it hurts, so that one can be built up in you. So Lord, we pray that, Lord, the brilliance of our church will be based on genuine love in you and for others. We also want to heed the warning, O God, to not be a stumbling block to your work. Lord, many times, O God, we put in our own wisdom in doing things. O God, Lord, we want to repent of that if in any way we have been. We do not see the way you work. And we pray, O God, that Lord, we will continually be receptive of what the Holy Spirit us and guide us, so that Lord, we indeed, O God, we will do what pleases you. So Father, hear our prayers, reveal us in your word, seek deep into our hearts, and bear fruits according to your will. And all this we pray in Jesus' name.